one of them shall fall to the ground without the will of your heavenly Father. Then fear nothing. You are worth more than many sparrows. You should believe that it is for my good and for my peace. You have seen and felt my labors, cross, persecutions, and afflictions which I have endured, and have personally experienced them when you accompanied me in the travels of my exile. Now my God has extended his hand to receive me into his blessed kingdom. I shall see it before you, and when it shall please the Lord, you shall follow me. This separation is not for all time. The Lord will receive you also to join us together again in our head, Jesus Christ. I pray you, my dearly beloved, to console yourself by meditating on these things. Consider the honor that God has done you in giving you a husband who was not only a minister of the Son of God, but so esteemed of God that he allowed him to have the crown of martyrs. It is an honor the like of which God has never even given to the angels. I am practicing now what I have preached to others, and I must confess that when I preach, I would speak about the things that I am now actually experiencing as a blind man speaks of color. Since I was taken prisoner, I have profited more and learned more than during the rest of my life. Our Lord permits me, on the one hand, to feel my weakness and my smallness, that I am but a small vessel on the earth, very fragile, to the end that he would humble me so that all the glory of the victory may be given to him. On the other hand, he fortifies me and consoles me in an unbelievable way. I have more comfort than the enemies of the gospel. I eat, drink, and rest better than they do. I am held in a very strong prison, very bleak, obscure, and dark. The prison is known by the obscure name Brunane, or Brownie. The air is poor and it stinks. On my feet and my hands I have irons big and heavy. They are a continual hell, hollowing my limbs up to my poor bones. Farewell, Catherine, my dearly beloved. I pray that God has given me the grace to write for your benefit in such a way that you may be consoled in this poor world. Keep my letter as a remembrance of me. Continue your love for me by extending it all the more to our children. Remember, God is the husband of poor widows and the father of poor orphans. He will never leave you. Of that I can assure you. I will write my friends to care for you. But if means are lacking, then find some good man who fears God. Commend me to my good mother. I hope to write some consolation to her if it pleases God. Greet also my good sister. May she take her affliction to God. Grace be with you. At the prison, 12 April 1567. It looks like he's signing off just now. Your faithful husband, Guido de Bret, minister of the Word of God at Valenciennes, and presently prisoner for the Son of God at the aforesaid place. Well, how had it come to this? Guy de Bret, or Guido de Bret, was born in 1522. That's the year that Luther wrote his letter of consolation to von Kronberg. He was born in what is now southern Belgium. John Calvin was then 13 years old, and Luther had posted his 95 theses some 5 years before. Change was happening. We know very little about Guido's childhood, except that while he was yet in the womb, his mother was deeply desiring that her child would be a son and that he would be a preacher. We're not sure exactly what she understood by that. Guido traveled to Lausanne and Geneva in time to obtain the best theological education. Sometime in his late 20s, he traveled to England and joined a congregation of refugees, Reformed believers who were welcomed by the young King Edward VI. Here, Guy, or Guido, learned much as well. And he could have stayed in England, which was still at peace, or gone home and faced persecution. And he chose the latter for the love of Christ and his fellow believers in southern Belgium. Ministering to the persecuted churches there, at that time, he never stayed in one place too long. He often changed his name, sometimes grew his beard and sometimes trimmed it, and he had different sets of clothing. All this to avoid capture. I found his name as author on only one of the several books and thousands of pages he published in his lifetime. His dear Catherine Ramone must have been a courageous woman, for she married this man without an earthly home when he was 38 years old in the midst of his dangerous ministry. By the age of 39 in 1561, he had in strict secrecy finished a confession of faith that the Reformed churches call the Netherlands Confession or the Belgic Confession. It's very beloved to us. And because it was so scriptural and beautiful in its contents, many Reformed churches adopted it almost immediately. They did it at synods that had code words for the cities that they lived in, like Antwerp was called the Vine. About this time, the number of illegal Reformed believers had grown so large in Guido's city that they dared openly to sing the Genevan Psalms in the street by night. This is 1561. It was a show of strength. But Guido did not support this because he knew that the government would interpret this as an act of disobedience, perhaps even treason. He was right. In his preface to the Belgic Confession, he tried to overcome the danger by emphasizing that true believers prayed for and obeyed the government in all good things. And he also wrote, "We are, it is alleged, disobedient rebels, intent only on the destruction of civil government, throwing the world into confusion and disorder. We're accused of being bent only on breaking free from your authority and power, indeed on snatching the scepter from your hands, and people say of us, throw the Christians to the lions." But the banishments, prisons, racks, exiles, tortures, and countless other persecutions plainly demonstrate that our desire and conviction is not to rule this earth, for we would lead a far easier life if we did not embrace this doctrine. But having the fear of God before our eyes and being in dread of the warning of Jesus Christ, who tells us that he shall forsake us before God his Father if we deny him for men before men, we suffer our backs to be whipped, our tongues to be cut out, our mouths to be gagged, and our whole bodies to be burnt, rather than deny the truth of this gospel. You can turn on the lights. Debray had written this preface in utmost secrecy and had it printed with the beloved confession. The copy was tossed over the castle wall as a testimony to the government with that preface. But he kept his own identity as author a secret. He had also instructed one of his closest workers that if he, Guido, was caught, the back shed in which he had worked was his study, which contained copies of the confession, was to be burnt up. Now, when the authorities were tipped off to find Guido, the man who was to torch his workshop failed, and the secret was out. Guido fled yet again, this time with his new wife, probably with their first baby as well. He could not help but preach the gospel. And he continued in many other important cities in the French language there in the southern lowlands. The church kept growing, so did his family, five precious children, so did the number of books he wrote to defend the church in her truth. The year 1566 in the Netherlands was called the year of wonder, or miracles, when crowds of 5,000 and 6,000 and more were gathering in fields every day for 6 or 7 weeks to hear his preaching and the preaching of his friends and other men. God was granting conversions by the thousands. Praise the Lord. But this too attracted the authorities' attention. And so as the gospel moved from the French lands into the French-speaking lowlands and then into the Dutch-speaking lowlands, the authorities clamped down yet again. William of Orange was fighting for the freedom of the Dutch, but he didn't yet succeed until later. And so in 1567, Guy de Bray was captured and tossed in the hellhole of the Brunei prison, chained in its bowels, which indeed had the sewer flowing through them. From this prison, he wrote the letter with which we just heard a moment ago. The letter to his wife was written in April. A month later, he was still active, being interrogated by a Roman Catholic bishop. And we have the record of that. There's a reason why we have the records of interrogations of Protestants. It's because the Roman Catholic authorities still wanted to follow law and order, so they needed to ascertain that you were actually guilty of heresy, and so they needed to record the proceedings of the Inquisition trials. And these were often smuggled out, and the Protestants used them in their books of martyrs. So what do we find when we look at this account of his interrogation? Well, Guido could accurately quote scripture and many early church writers from memory. He was powerful in argument and never wavered from the truth. When the bishop charged Guido with preferring his own private judgment to that of the whole church, he replied that he was following the judgment of scripture and of the early church, not this recent Roman Catholic church with all of its human traditions. Guido added that he would gladly celebrate the Mass and believe in transubstantiation if Jesus had indeed commanded it and it was biblical. And the bishop, this is very interesting, for his part, he admitted that he would, if he would follow his own private judgment, he would doubt the sacrifice of the Mass. He added, but so what? So what? The church has indeed determined and settled the matter, and one ought simply to believe it. So, in the bishop's view, the church formed and determined the Bible, but in our view, and in the Bible's own view, which is God's work, God's view, the Bible is God's holy revelation, which alone must form and determine all that the church believes. You know, in time, the Roman Catholic position was described as the coal miner's faith, or the collier's faith, because here's what a coal miner once answered when he was asked what he believed. So, what do you believe? Answer, I believe what the church believes. Question, what does the church believe? Answer, well, the church believes what I believe. Well, then what is it that both you and the church believe? Why? We believe the very same thing. Now, here there is no longer direct contact with the life-saving Word of God. There's no study of the Scriptures, and consequently no life for the church, just a mindless following of what the priest says. Not so, says the Lord, for you are all a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. You are all called to know me from the least to the greatest. No matter your age here, littlest child sleeping on the floor in the back row, already called from childhood, from birth, from the womb to know the Lord. Kingdom of priests. So he says, my Holy Spirit is poured out upon all of you. Know my word, find my church, join it, and bend your necks under the yoke of Jesus Christ, serving the edification of your brothers and sisters, as Guido de Bray, in his Christ-like way, did for you. I'm reflecting there Article 28 of the Belgic Confession. On 31 May 1567, Guido and his colleagues said was holding the paper in the ink pot, were hung. They could have been burned as heretics, but they were condemned, first of all, as treasonous, as disobeying the authorities and endangering their country. And being judged of this particular crime entailed the sentence of hanging. Yet Guido de Bray's last words were an admonition from the scaffold to his people, his flock, to obey the ordained authorities. How remarkable, coming from a man supposedly guilty of treason. They had to get him on something. So it was treason. Well, what can we learn from the life, love, and death of this faithful servant of God, and from the letter of consolation that Luther penned so early in the Reformation? Well, I have seven lessons. Number one, surely we can learn to be committed to the truth of the gospel, and that to be committed to the truth of the gospel is worth more than your own earthly life. It's the treasure hidden in the field. So number one, the gospel is worth more than your own earthly life. Number two, persecution is to be expected and can be endured by faith in Christ. Some of us will suffer. Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Fear nothing but God's judgment. So your faith is worth more than your life, and fear nothing on earth but the judgment of God. The third thing, even in the worst situation, God's Spirit will enable true believers to love others as Guido de Bray loved his wife and children and church, including you and me, all those who would know Christ and would even read over his shoulder this letter. So God's Spirit will enable us to be gentle, loving, charitable, kind. Let's trust God on that very point. Number four, then the Belgic Confession is the work of one of Christ's faithful martyrs and our treasure. Of all the Reformed confessions, this one is unique in sealing its truth by the death of its author, stating that we have everything in Christ. There's one other confession that was sealed by the death of its authors, for sure. 1558, the Guanabara Confession, the first Reformed confession written in the Americas by four Huguenot tradesmen, all about 21 years old. And it's a fabulous work that they did, quoting church fathers and scripture from memory and dying for it. But the difference is that it was never adopted by a church. So number four was the Belgic Confession is our treasure from one of Christ's faithful martyrs. Number five, all believers are called to know the Lord personally through his word and to aim for Christian maturity. He wants us to radiate Christ's name everywhere. Guido de Bray died because he refused to hide his faith. So we're called to know the Lord personally and then radiate his name everywhere, to be as a savory scent in this world and as a salt and a light and a saving influence. Number six, God expects his office bearers to lead his people in obedience to God, in love for his church, and with a clear defense or apologetic account of the true Christian faith. God expects that of those who are to lead. My brothers, if you are called to lead, equip yourselves. Be strong and courageous for the love of Christ. And finally, for all of us, doesn't this all show, and haven't we seen that throughout our conference, that God works all things together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose? Trust in the good providence of your God. And I will close then with looking to our Lord Jesus Christ in the words of Philippians chapter 2, to his greatness and say, I must be glorious and glorified in the eyes of all people. But he made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a